Hi, good evening and welcome. My name is Jean Priscilli, and I am the director of the Walsh Gallery here at Seton Hall University. I'd like to thank each of you for joining us this evening as we present Kiki and Seton Smith in conversation with Lynne Tillman. They'll be on stage shortly, and we'll indicate who is who when they come on the stage. I just wanted to make some very brief remarks, and then we can get on with the program. So this event marks the occasion of the Walsh Gallery exhibition, Kiki and Seton Smith, A Sense of Place. And for those of you who have yet to see it, it will be on view through this Friday, the 9th, at from 10:30 to 4:30, the remainder of the week. And if we have a critical mass and people haven't seen the show, we can also open up the gallery for a tiny bit after the talk. We're really proud. It's such a proud moment for the Walsh Gallery and Seton Hall University as we welcome Kiki and Seton Smith back to South Orange. And I'd also like to thank the Lenny Piero Memorial Art Foundation for organizing this exhibition through a number of important relationships and collaborative efforts. Thank you very much for that. And I'd especially like to thank Kiki and Seton Smith for sharing their art with Seton Hall and the larger community around South Orange. Before we move on, I would like to introduce the woman who really was the driving force in all of this, and that is Judy Wukich, the director of the Lenny Piero Memorial Art Foundation. And those of you from South Orange or the local neighborhood, I'm sure you're very familiar with her name. She's been a mainstay here producing art events and other types of events for many, many years, and it's been wonderful working with her. Thank you. And so at this time, I'd like to ask Judy to come to the stage and make a few brief remarks before we begin the program.
Believe me, it's a mutual admiration society here. It's been such a pleasure working with Seton and Kiki Smith and working with Jean Brazil to make this happen. So as you know, my name is Judy Wukich. I'm the president of the Piero Foundation, which started honoring my late husband, Lenny Piero, whose dream was to bring a sculpture by the famous sculptor Tony Smith, who was second generation South Orange. And that was the Piero Foundation's first initiative that we did. And we have Tau now in Meadowland Park. And since then, the Piero Foundation, since 2002, has presented annually significant and unique arts programs in South Orange, generally brought to the township and the area through small grants, private foundations, and the passion of many, many people who devote their skills, their time, their talent to making these things happen. The tribute exhibition, A Sense of Place, I'm going to put my glasses on. Excuse me, my type got smaller. The tribute exhibition, A Sense of Place, provides another opportunity to honor two of the town's most distinguished honors and artists by considering their formative influences that were from their upbringing here in Essex County, New Jersey. It's positioning their work and their lives in their artwork and how it is represented today. And Kiki and Seton Smith are third generation to reside in South Orange. Key to this exhibition is the idea that place forever impacts our sense of place, something I am finding as I get older to be more and more obvious to me and in speaking with many people. Their imagery, use of space, perceptions of art were influenced by growing up but with two artistic parents, Tony Smith and their operatic mother, Jane Lawrence Smith, in a rambling old Victorian home in the Montrose section of South Orange. Kiki and Seton have both gone on to become famous, both in their own ways. And I'd like to read a quote by Kiki that I took from her catalog for A Gathering, which was a retrospective of her work from 1980 to 2005, where she states, "My father was an artist. I spent the first 18 years of my life working for him. Everything revolved around the work. We participated, me and my sisters, in helping facilitate the work. It's really a great way to learn about art, the world, and community." And these familial ties that we all feel to where we grew up, where we lived, and our family to our hometowns, I hope inspires all of us, as it certainly has inspired them. This concept is very exciting for me personally. So allow me now to give a brief background to each of our three guests tonight. I'm providing a bit more of an intimate understanding of their lives rather than a straightforward resume where I'm just listing their accomplishments, which are many. Kiki Smith was born in a U.S. Army hospital in Nuremberg, Germany, following her mother's singing tour with an opera company. The following year, her family returned to live in the family's home in South Orange. She attended public schools and entered Changes Incorporated, an experimental high school in Maplewood. While she briefly attended Hartford Art College and traveled throughout the country, Kiki settled in New York City in 1976, working odd jobs, which I love to say, a factory where she airbrushed clouds and starbursts onto dresses, an electrician's assistant, a short order cook. That's always been one of my bucket lists that I wanted to do, where she continued to meet and work with other artists. And just like your background growing up impacts everything you do, I also believe all the odd things we've done on our journey in life impacts as well. She also took numerous workshops and classes in etching and other forms of printmaking. It was at this time Kiki also began to copy microscopic illustrations of cells and nerves and organs from the Gray's Anatomy, the famous book, beginning her in-depth exploration of the human anatomy and its intimate functions. Kiki has had exhibitions in major venues throughout the United States and Europe, and has been in the art of the Whitney Biennial and the Venice Biennial many times. Her materials have been as varied as her exhibitions, including printmaking and sculpture and books and glass and metal and wax, and it seems anything she can get her hands on. A number of recognitions include Time Magazine's Time 100, The People Who Shape Our World, in 2006. In 2012, she received the U.S. State Department Medal of Arts from Hillary Clinton, and in 2016, she was awarded the International Sculptor Center's Lifetime Achievement in Contemporary Sculpture Award. Seton Smith was born in South Orange and raised in South Orange and graduated from Changes Incorporated, the alternative high school in Maplewood. She went on to study photography and the arts in various programs at Sarah Lawrence, Bennington College, Boston U, the Museum School in Boston, Massachusetts College of Art, all through the 70s. In 1985, Seton moved to Paris, where she lived, worked, and exhibited for 20 years. And it's while there her exhibitions included venues in Germany, Paris, and Reims, as well as the Whitney Museum of Art in New York. A 10-year retrospective of her work was published in 1995 in conjunction with an exhibition at Le Capitole in Paris. Seton returned to New York in 2004, continuing to study at the Museum of Folk Art, New School, Cooper Union, and NYU. And I mention these because of the, for me, rather unexpected topics of study, which includes a broad spectrum such as history of urbanism in the United States, American history, history of the suburbs, globalization and public spaces of cities, and the history of gardens. These concepts are reflected throughout her work and provide to me further insight into her vision and her creative thought process. Seton has continued to exhibit her work in Europe and has been visiting targeted areas recently in the U.S. for photographing: North Dakota, Georgia, South Carolina, Santa Fe, and many of these photographs are in the exhibition today over at Walsh Gallery. Our moderator with us tonight, Lynne Tillman, writes novels, short stories, and essays. Her novels include No Lease on Life, a finalist for a National Book Critics Circle Award, and American Genius, a comedy, which the millions cited as one of the best books of the millennium so far. Her most recent story collection was Someday This Will Be Funny, and a new one, The Complete Madam Realism and Other Stories, which has recently been published. Tillman also writes nonfiction, which includes The Velvet Years, Warhol's Factory, 1965 to 67, and she writes frequently for artist books and museum catalogs. Tillman's second book of essays, What Would Lynne Tillman Do?, was a finalist for the National Book Circle Award in Criticism in 2014. She writes a bi-monthly column for Freeze Art Magazine, received a Guggenheim Fellowship and a Creative Capital Warhol Foundation grant for the arts, writing in 2014. Her sixth novel, Men and Apparitions, will appear in 2017. So it's obvious from all these resumes that I've just read that we have very significant people joining us tonight. And it's my distinct honor and my great, great pleasure to turn the evening over to Kiki Smith, Seton Smith, and Lynne Tillman.
To give you a little bit of background, I've known Kiki since 1978, and I've known Seton, I think I met you about the next year, or maybe that. So we've known each other a long time, and I think we've all seen each other go through many different phases in our life. I first wanted to ask you, I was looking at the exhibition again, Seton, and I wondered if you could tell us where those houses were shot. Were they from different ones of the series? Different series?
Yeah, they're different series. As Judy mentioned, North Dakota.
Are you hearing back there? No. Yeah, I think you have to have it right in front of your mouth. You maybe could pick it up.
North Dakota and Georgia and Vermont and I don't know, just different places around like that.
Are you hearing her better? Okay. Because of course it relates to sense of place that you chose to show those photographs, and I was thinking about the house you grew up in and wondered how you felt about that house when you were a child. Do you remember specific feelings about it and being in it?
Well, I wouldn't say the house was haunted, but it was, and it wasn't dark especially. But it was, there was something very sinister about the house, I think.
Sinister?
Yeah. And so that influenced me a lot about my work. And when I, 20 years ago, when I was starting to work on architecture, I was really thinking of it as a place where you go into with your emotional background and you have psychological and emotional reactions to every space you go in, and you know how to act in a bank or a temple or a tea house. They all present different possibilities, and we intuitively know how to act in those spaces.
What was it that you felt was sinister in your home?
Well, it was creaky in the winter, and there was an aunt who almost died there.
And what then, almost died there?
An aunt of ours.
Oh, an aunt, okay.
Yeah, and then our grandfather died there. And there was a staircase going up to another section of the house. And my father put a mirror on the staircase. So I still can't walk down the stairs properly because it's, you walk down the stairs, but then you see your image going down the stairs at the same time. So
So it made you self-conscious as you walked down the stairs.
Yeah.
It's an interesting thing that Tony Smith did.
To bring more light into the staircase. But
I see. But it also brought your reflection.
Yeah.
To Kiki, yeah. What about you in terms of your that house, same house?
Oh, I never thought of it as sinister. I would say it was active, maybe in a way. But I don't know. I loved it. But there was, you know, my father was born 1912, so, you know, it was built as a summer house, and there was no insulation, so it was freezing cold and things like that, but his parents had lived in the house, and then his parents had died when he was 18, and then when he came back from Europe when I was born, they moved in there, but all his parents' things that were left were in the attic, so it was filled with things from the 19th century, you know, clothes from the 19th century and dentures and death letters and, you know, there was just tons and tons of stuff. And then the rest of the house was completely empty because his aunt had taken away all the furniture.
Yeah. Was the stuff in the attic?
Yeah, yeah.
Did you go up to the attic?
Yeah, yeah. I spent lots of time, unfortunately, destroying all the 19th century clothes as teenagers. But, but it was a big house. You know, the houses around here are quite large. It was a very big house to grow up in. And it definitely had steam heat. It definitely made lots of noises and things like that. And there were squirrels running in the ceilings at night and bees in the walls. And but
were you very, both of you, were you very aware of your parents being artists? Is that something you were very conscious of as when you were kids?
Yeah. It was sort of the preoccupation of the family, I would say, and my mother would always say, just remember the most important thing is your work in your life, and it wasn't getting married or having children or doing things like that. And she had stopped her operatic career because we were born, so we felt badly about that. And Tony was just working all the time, and he had a special area in the house, which was originally built as a gym for his brothers, because there were like six or so children or something like that, and then one sister, and she lived in an apartment above this gym space, and that became his studio. And so we would visit him in his studio a lot. Kiki.
There was nothing meant anything besides art. There was really, and I remember my mother too, like what she was saying, I remember my mother saying, like, no one cares if Beethoven had a good life. And I remember thinking, I want a good life. I don't want to do this all day long. But, existed besides art. There wasn't really any concern for anything else whatsoever, I don't think.
I knew their mother. I got to know her pretty well. And one time she and I went to a party that Kiki was giving, and you were then living all the way down the East River. I mean, right on the East River in this... I don't know, it was like almost a four-floor sort of shack or something. It was really not in good shape. And it was impossible to get there except by cab. There were no subways near it. And it got later and later, and Jane luckily had a car. And she said, would I like a lift home? And I almost literally jumped in her car. But as we went down the stairs in this desolate, really desolate space along the East River, your mother said, doesn't Kiki have the most romantic front yard in the world? So her viewpoint was so unlike most mothers' viewpoints. And she didn't seem, for both of you, she, from what I felt, she encouraged your adventurousness, your interest in the world. When you moved to Paris, when was that, Seton?
In 1985.
Why did you decide to do that then?
Well, it was the time the East Village was popular and painting, and even though I was painting, I didn't feel like I related to the work. And I met some German artists who were working around architecture. And so that interested me. And I also wanted to go photograph gardens and things like that. And I just went to stay for a little while and ended up staying 20 years.
Yeah, I wanted to talk to you about that in relationship to a sense of place, because living in another country for such a long time has to have affected, in some sense, your sense of place or your perspective about home, let's say.
Yeah, I think in that kind of situation, you're always between two cultures and you're comparing one culture to the other culture, and people are saying, is this better, is that better, and things like that. But I was photographing a lot in museums and in chateaus, and but they were just the regular buildings there, really. You know, I wasn't looking for something precious or something like that. And it's enriched my life a lot to be in a different culture. And I still live there half the year.
I was thinking about, Kiki, your work. Some of the themes in your work, which have religious overtones or are directly related to ideas in Catholicism and certainly spirituality. As we were driving here, you said to Seton, oh, there's our church. That's the church we went to. And I said, what was the name of it? And you said, the Lady of Sorrows. And I thought, wow, that was the beginning of Kiki's art career. And I just wondered about the part that, I was curious what kind of religious upbringing you had, because I've never asked you that.
We had, my father went to St. Francis Xavier in New York, a Jesuit high school, and then he went to Georgetown. So in Washington for a very short time, because then his parents died, but so he was raised by Jesuits, and his family was very active in, I think, making Our Lady of Sorrows, and very active in South Orange in the community. And my mother was like Episcopalian or something. And then she converted to Catholicism when they married. And she took like lessons. She was in Germany. He was here, but she was in Germany, and she took lessons, you know, to become a Catholic. And then she became Hindu and Buddhist later in her life. But so she had a very fluid sense of spirit. And you know, my father, like, he didn't go to church. He came to church when we were, had, you know, like Holy Communion or something like that, but he didn't go to church. My mother sort of would try to organize us going to church, and we stopped, you know, when we were relatively young. But certainly for me, church and Our Lady of Sorrows, because it's a, you know, neo-Gothic church, was a tremendous influence on my life, because, you know, we grew up around abstract expressionist painting, and my father's work was abstract, while at the same time it was very monotheistic in general, like in a general sense, it's singular. Everything's very singular. And but you know, the church was so filled with stories and with sort of wonder of materials, of stained glass, of wood, of all these different things, and the idea of objects holding meaning, you know, and concentrating meaning, you know, that the Catholics sort of believe in the, you know, physical manifestation of the spiritual world through objects, through reliquary, through your relationship to objects, you know, in a way like Hinduism, you know, it has correlations to Hinduism of objects holding things, you know, whereas other Christian religions are more, have a more social model, you know, that community model, you know, rather than a ritual model of, and so, if, yeah, for me, I was just extremely attracted to it. You know, just this idea that objects can hold something.
Seton?
Are we talking about church?
Church or religion or... did either of you take communion?
Yes.
Yeah, you did. So you had instruction.
Yeah, we went to catechism, yeah. Let's see.
Confirmation.
And one of my favorite books was something like 50 Lives of Saints. And I set up a little installation in our house with, we had for some reason a Mother Mary sculpture. And I set up some kind of little installation with it. And then Tony said he didn't like it because it was kitsch, and
it
I should
kitsch.
Give it to the neighbors.
And what?
I should give it to the neighbors.
I think it was probably because the Mother Mary was from his parents.
Oh.
Or something, one of the things left over from, you know, like big plaster.
How old were you, Seton, when you had this first art criticism?
Oh, I don't know, maybe 11 or something like 10 or something like that. And I think our mother more embodied a spiritual aspect of life than we have, for me anyway.
Well, your work is both of your, I mean, the differences between you are very compelling to me. I have two much older sisters, and the three of us are very different from each other in so many ways. And it's always been interesting to me that people grow up in the same family, have the same parents, sit at the same dinner table, but of course are sitting at a very different dinner table in their own mind. And what happens individually, subjectively, in each person or sibling is so different. And yeah, it shows in your work. Mm-hmm. There are, there are so many differences. I was just, maybe you could stop here. If we look at this, oh, could you go back? Although I love cats, I have to say. Yeah, these two sculptures, this installation of yours, to me brings together something that's in other parts of your work. Your interest in the human body, and that's that corporeal quality in your work, and your interest in the animal and the animal in the human, which I don't see in your work at all. I mean, it's as if when you do interiors, and you had some that you, I think you were showing in Paris, and maybe some in New York, maybe mm-hmm. confused, your sense of the interior is very different from Kiki's, which might include vitrines of blood or big pharmaceutical bottles of blood. And that's such an interesting difference to me. I don't know if you want to Would you say something about that, please?
No, I just think we've both, you know, gone in our own directions, and I think we're very close, and so we can follow each other's work for a long period of time, and that's, you know, if there's criticism, it's very well thought out, and but yeah, we're just very different in our way of working.
You know, for me, I don't know, about 10 years ago or something, I had this idea, like, Seton and I are tethered to Stanley Road, like we're walked out of that house.
The street they grew up on.
We walked out of the house on strings, you know, on different strings, sort of going in different directions, but it goes back to that. Like, for me, Seton's work as my father's work is completely internal. I understand it completely on an internal, visceral way. You know, it doesn't feel, neither of their works feels foreign to me or something. It's completely familial to me. And it resonates, like it has an emotional resonance that I recognize, you know, and yeah, about place and space and one's relationship to space.
One thing that's interesting when you were talking about the church and stories, the way in which, if everyone in some sense making something tells a story, I mean, one can hardly escape the way in which things become stories, particularly to a viewer who might be interpreting it. But for instance, on that piece of yours, I mean, you can go forward now, thanks, where you have, it's on a road, and then you have the billboard of the trees. Which is something that Kiki's never done, and I can't imagine her really doing that, but then Kiki will do something with trees that makes them more physical. I mean, by having a representation of the trees as an image, you're already talking about nature as an image. And Kiki will, and forgive me if I'm going off the deep end in some way, but Kiki will want to make that more into a story that's readily available, that you can walk into, like the fairy tales that you're interested in.
Well, I don't know. It's all symbol. It's all, you know, like symbol language. I mean, like if I look at Seton's billboard, I can also say that's like an icon of, you know, it functions also like an icon standing to say, pay attention.
Pay attention, yes.
Like pay attention.
But to me, it's very—it's marking a kind of conceptual move where she's saying, "Here's an image of something that you're
surrounded
looking at,"
by.
And it reminds me—it not exactly, but Stephen Shore has done some things like this, but yours is different because it's much closer. The way the billboard sits on the land. Is on the road is much closer. When he did something a little bit similar but quite different, it was much farther apart. Mm-hmm. With your work, Kiki, I always feel that I'm engaged in a kind of illusion that's based on some kind of story behind. There's some narrative that's in your mind, and that these are elements from it.
Not every little bit you do.
Because
for me in general, like I'm either interested in like kind of more fractured narratives, because I find narratives as a trap, mm-hmm. you know, like a story as a trap, you know. So, but I know that they're elements. you know, or like making shows or something, you put some elements in a room, like a theater.
And you're noticing these elements that Kiki is dealing with.
But it's not like a specific narrative. Mm-hmm. Like they're very general, open narratives, because, you know, people say, well, what does that mean? I'd go like,
no, I don't mean that it's a...
I don't mean it to have any literal meaning, or even to myself it doesn't. You know, it just is like what happens. Like what happens if you make a situation like that.
Some of your early work that you did in Paris, Seton, worked with both sculpture and photography. I don't know if we've... This is Kiki's. That you did on 8th Avenue and 42nd Street. And some of the titles tell you some of the elements in them, where did I put it? There was Tree Ending, Mirror Pool with Arch, and Covered Platform with Boat Landing and Tree Alley. So she names the
elements in a very natural way.
Yes, yeah.
Well, that came out of, I was painting when I first came to New York in 79. I was painting screens with architectural images on them, and they were very simple paintings. And then I got interested in the screen as a portable room. And from there, I went to putting the idea of things in flux in a space, and that we could be more open in how we live. And so I started putting images of other architectural spaces in installation, and then door panels, they look like door panels, but the idea was they were walls from other spaces, and that you could kind of transit between these different spaces, and it had an allegorical kind of idea behind it. The one with the covered platform is about, it has a tree alley, and the idea is that and also a river, and so the river is to take you on like a journey to death, and the tree alley is eternity, and then the platform, covered platform, is from a Persian garden, so it's about paradise gardens, and I love miniatures of that type, and so they all had different clues, but of course people, you know, interpret them as they want to.
Which is good, because if only your interpretation held, then people would say, well, that's what it means, and I don't need to look at it again.
And one was about AIDS, and first it was about the idea of medieval painting and how the hierarchy has changed, who's the smaller people and the bigger people and the architecture and so on. And so I had these different scales of doors, and then there was a structure with a mirror on top, which represented someone looking up from the grave. And
there's that mirror again.
Yeah. But a lot of my work has to do with mirrors, and they look sometimes cinematic, but it's really more the idea of looking into a mirror and seeing all different slices of space in the mirror that are completely disjunctive. Anyway, that was a longer answer.
No, and it's interesting too, because at a certain point you began to blur the image in other photographs, but we can get back to that. What were you thinking when she was saying what she was saying?
I was thinking Seton is much more narrative than I am. You know, like having more, you know, but I think everybody does that. It's just, you're like, you have that an image or something occurs to you, I always think something becomes apparent to you, to be attentive to it. And it can hold all different kinds of meanings, and those meanings hopefully for you also aren't fixed, or they resonate. They, you know, can ripple out or change their meaning over time, or, you know, and some of it's extremely situational, why you do things, or circumstantial, why something happens at a given moment. But hopefully those things are all in flux all the time.
One of the things that's very always been amazing to me about your work, Kiki, and it was, Judy mentioned it in the beginning, was all the different materials you work with. And in a way, one of the ways I've thought about it, whether it's working with paper, different kinds of paper, making bodies from certain kind of paper, or using rice paper, and or when you started working with glass, that you had different ideas about what those materials could mean to you or could mean in a work. Like the material itself, that materiality suggested forms or ideas.
Yeah, I mean, you know, certainly in the 70s, or coming to New York in the 70s, it was the material is the message, you know, that it is inherent in the qualities of the materials or the attributes of materials that holds a meaning. If you make something out of a rock or you make it out of paper, they have completely different historical, cultural meanings, but they also have radically different physical meanings and physical properties and different relationship to your body and are doing different things to your body and stuff. But, you know, to me, it's really just curiosity. You know, because all these different materials have incredibly beautiful and amazing histories. You know, how people have worked with, you know, how they have discovered materials or discovered compounds of materials or whatever, and then how that has been used and how radically it changes over centuries to have very different meanings, very different economies about them, just everything, you know.
I remember when you and I first talked, or one of our first conversations about art was the importance of craft to you, and learning how to do something, that it wasn't just about using the material, but it was very important for you to know how to do the thing, not for it to be respecting of the material in that way.
Well, it also gives you something to do.
Yes. You know?
I remember because I made an interview with another artist colleague of ours, Barbara Bloom, once for Bomb Magazine, and I was going like, what do you do if you don't make your work, if you're not sitting there doing your work all day long, what do you do? Like, there's a lot of time in the day.
What did Barbara Bloom say?
Well, she was very content thinking about things and reading books and different, you know, doing other kinds of other ways to approach things. And I realized I need the physical experience. I need ownership. Part of its own, like having holy metals, it's like I want them, you know, working for me in my hand, you know, like I want it through my body, through the energy from my body.
Seton, what about you? How do you feel during the day? Do you feel? not every day or something.
I feel like I was in the transport business between my inventory and storage and moving things all around. But one thing I wanted to say is that I think our father really taught us not to be afraid of materials and building things and going from small scale to a large scale. And so we both in our own way, I think, looked at it as an opportunity that we could build anything we wanted, really. And I think that was a great gift he gave us. And Kiki's taking that.
Kiki is always using her hands.
Yeah, when, no, yes. I'm not.
Kiki and I once did a conversation in, where was that? Detroit, at the Detroit Institute of Art, and Kiki I did a reading, Kiki shows slides, and then we went on to the stage, and they had these sort of ornate 19th century chairs for us to sit in, and Kiki was then knitting all the time. And I was very used to it, and my mother used to knit also, so she's knitting and we're talking. And and some people came up to me after and said, weren't you insulted that she wasn't paying attention? I said, oh, she was paying attention. She was just knitting also.
That also some people are attentive through, some people are more attentive through doing something physical at the same time. You know, it's just a way. But I think it's true. I think it's absolutely true. I mean, we were three girls. My father didn't have any sons, so we did everything. We moved his sculptures around the backyard. You know, he would give us big lessons about the Egyptians moving things on logs. You know, we'd run around and put the log in front and then roll it a couple more feet, you know, and he'd give us lectures about, you know, fulcrums and wedges and, you know, endless things. You know, how do you slide rulers? You know, you'd ask him what's like 2 times 3 to make your homework easy, and you know, you'd learn how to use a slide rule for the next 5 hours lessons, and you know, but he really did. And to me, I am appalled, and I say, if any of you are having children, teach your children how to be in the physical world. I am appalled by my friends' children who know how to do nothing physically whatsoever. We had to do everything because there was only us to do it, but it's a it's really important to me as a human being that, you know, or at least you should take like emergency medical techniques or something like that, you know, that you learn how to be someplace physically in the world for 5 seconds.
I went to Hunter College when I never took, I took my electives. I was an English major, American history minor, but I took all my electives in studio art, and I saw your father. I never took a course with him because he sort of terrified me, and I was just an English major. Everybody else was art majors. But I heard him one time so angry at one of his art students who had just called up a company to manufacture her work, and he said, you can't do that. You have to learn how to make it yourself. And it was such an interesting clash because now there are a lot of people.
But it's also exactly what he did.
Yes, I mean, he didn't, but he would have thought, but he knew how to make something. And that was one of his points. I know how to make this. You shouldn't be asking other, you should know how to make this too. Do you remember him saying things like that?
No.
No.
Maybe you have more to say on that subject.
Well, we can switch to another subject. It's very interesting to me to have two artists as parents, but I suppose that's why I kept dwelling on it. Your photographs of houses, they're pretty much vernacular houses, and around America in different places. It's interesting when you were talking about being in Paris and photographing chateaus, but not as a precious thing. And that comparison between photographing more elaborate houses compared with the houses you're doing now, I just wondered, what was that also about, a kind of cultural dissonance or?
Yeah, I think when I came back, I was photographing interiors for many years and occasionally objects in museums. And when I came back to America, I really thought I wanted to photograph houses, the exteriors of houses. And I switched to black and white. It was a big move for me. And I'm taking more and more photographs of dilapidated houses and in poor neighborhoods, and just partly just to show what that's like, really, that we're not used to seeing it in a way. And the lives that are in those, you know, we can imagine people's lives growing up, you know, being married, children, grandparents, all those things, and the microcosm a house represents and how it's sort of uncanny that you are looking at the outside of a house, but you don't know what goes on inside the house. And it represents a sort of stability and all these different nice things, comforting things, but it can also represent things that are terrifying too. And so I think that they're particularly emotionally charged spaces.
Well, that goes back to what you were saying earlier about the house you grew up in felt a little sinister to you.
Yeah.
So imagining inside what's going on in these places, and we know that a lot of awful things go on, and yet the American dream was to at least own your own house, have your own house.
Yeah.
And you've been living on Ludlow Street a long time now. And like Kiki, you've changed your place a lot too. Architecturally, your place was very different when you first had it.
Yeah, at one point I decided to get rid of all the antiques and just go clean, which is better for me. But we also grew up with almost no furniture, and I feel comfortable with that.
With very little furniture.
And little things. I don't like people try and give me gifts, which I accept, of course, but I just don't want more things.
Well, your house does have that sort of minimal quality. It's very serene, and your work is very serene, I think.
Mm-hmm.
There is a way in which the surface of it, when you look at it, when you first look at it, it has this, I think, somber also quality, is something wanting you to, at least for me, reflect on this. There's a sort of seriousness to the work.
I think there's a quietness.
Yes.
And I gave a talk in Seoul, and the students were asking questions, and then they ended up deciding my work was really about death. And we had a long talk about that, about death.
Oh, about death.
So.
And do you think because of the stillness of your work?
Maybe. I think it's interiorized in a sense, and we, of course, all bring our own memories to spaces, but I'm not looking at them in a nostalgic way at all. I think of them more as propositions, and then we all react to them in different ways.
Kiki? Years ago, Kiki said to me something I found very profound, and talked about death, and I forget what we were talking about, and you said to me, Lynne, life wants to live. And I've thought about that a lot, how human beings, other creatures, struggle to live in often the most abject of circumstances. There's a wonderful essay by Virginia Woolf called The Death of the Moth. It's one of the most brilliant pieces I've ever read. It's just about 2 pages. If you get a chance, you should read it. And what she's doing is just looking at a day moth. She's in her studio, and she's in the country somewhere, and she notices in the window this day moth that lives 24 hours, and it's flying around, and then suddenly it stops flying. And she begins to see its struggle against death. I can never read it without weeping. It's so touching, but it's so much about any individual's struggle to live. I think your work often can have a kind of grotesque aspect to it. Certainly raw in a way, as when you made the sculpture with the, seemed like entrails coming out of a woman who's a sculpture of a woman crawling on the ground. And it's as if people are always in not just compromised situations, but dangerous situations, and moving forward, trying to. Is it 40? I mean, I know we're supposed to do a Q&A, but I don't know. Is it time?
Oh, yes. Yes,
I guess it is. Yes, it is. Okay. No. All right, life and death, we'll take questions now.
So you're ready for the Q&A?
Yeah.
Okay.
You're welcome.
So thank you all very much. For those of you who might have questions, we have a mic here. You're free to come up. We'll take, I don't know, a few people.
Yes, I guess I was interested in what you guys were saying about growing up here. What I wanted to know was how you guys see your work as related. Can you guys talk a little bit about that? About, is there any kind of similar starting point? Because as Lynne said, the work seems extremely different on the surface when you look at it. Do you see correspondences between the two of you at any time? Do you ever see things about things that one has said or thought about with the other? Is there any kind of interchange between the work that you do?
No, I think that they're, at least I could say that they're both feeling-based. Like we have very different motivations and reasons and curiosities and ideas about things, but to me, there's always, which is the same in my father's work, that there's a, like a feeling, and the idea that an image or a thing or something can hold a feeling. And because to me, I always experience Seton's work very emotionally. You know, maybe it's just me, but I experience it very emotionally the way I experience my father's work very emotionally. And it's not to say that it's to elicit a specific thing, but to me, it always feels like the germ of something. The possibility of.
I don't know if you started out asking about coming from here?
A little bit about, yeah, I think about family and about your relationship to your, you know, what Lynne was saying about having two artists for parents. I was, you know, an artist in Newark who teaches art in a school in Newark once said to me that when he has a Catholic when you have an African American student, he will always draw a portrait as the first thing that he does, a portrait of himself or a portrait of someone else, because African Americans feel they didn't control their own destiny or the way they were presented in history, so they're very interested in portraits. But when they have a Catholic student, the Catholic student draws whatever they imagine, because they have a sort of tradition, saying about images holding symbolic meaning or worth or emotional impact that's almost sacred. That's what he was saying. That was a whole imagination. I was just wondering if there was a relationship that you felt to that kind of idea.
No, I don't know.
No.
No.
The only thing I can say about that, which is also just from a very specific time moment, it was during the through AIDS, what was understood as the AIDS crisis or something in the 1980s and 90s, that The NEA was attacked by certain elements in society to stop funding the NEA. And the artists that lost funding in the NEA, or exhibitions that were supported by the NEA, were Robert Mapplethorpe, David Vonarovich, Louise Bourgeois, Robert Gober, myself, and one funding, but different artists. And she made this funny correlation. First, okay, certain amounts of the people were homosexual, so that was problematic in certain respects for people. But the other was they were all Catholics. And she said that the whole thing that was happening at that time was still a debate between Protestant religions and Catholic religion, which has dominated, you know, the history of America. And in one way has been like the Protestant or Puritanical base of America, and its repulsion and suspicion of image was extremely liberating for the culture. You know, it was enormous liberation for the culture not to be owned by these things. But and you know, she'd say like that the Catholics are fetishizing the world, and that it was just very interesting in these politically very charged political moments where it had lots of ramifications for art and for other aspects of the culture, but that it was still primarily this you know, dialogue going on, unresolved dialogue about the physical world, representation in the physical world. But that was just, it was her idea about it, you know, looking at it from another place.
I also wanted to say that those kinds of generalizations, whether it's about African Americans or Catholics, are always very dodgy, because you could have an African American Catholic. But also, when I think about a lot of contemporary artists I know, some of whom are African American, whether it's Glenn Ligon or Renee Green or Ellen Gallagher, people working with abstraction, they're not making self-portraits. It's because that kind of comment about African Americans could then be said about all women who make art, whose image, for the most part, was not controlled by them. So it's tricky to me to make a claim like that or an assertion like that.
Hello, Seton and Kiki. How are you? It's been a long time. Yes. 50 years ago, I met you. And we had such a great time over the years at Stanley Road, Berkeley Ave, all over South Orange. And your art has tremendously impacted a lot of people that we knew back then. Mm-hmm. And you know who I am now, don't you?
I can't see that.
It's hard to see.
I can't see you.
Nearsighted, so.
Alfonso.
Oh my God. Oh my God. I can't even see that well, but oh my God, that's amazing.
Yes, it is.
Wow.
Because you took me down memory lane talking about Stanley Road and the times that we had there, your mother and father. Incredible. You three girls, Kiki, Bibi, and Annie, well, Seton, were the most whole back then, being 15, 16 years old. I mean, we're going back 50 years. And the art that your father did, I mean, your father was incredible, and your mother also. I had so many good times in the kitchen with your mother, BB, and you. It was incredible. And the people that I met through you were just unreal. Comes to mind, further down Stanley Road, Walter and Rooster. Remember? So, you know, I wanted to ask, does any of the sculptures that your father had that were in the museum in New York and in the backyard, are they still viable? Are they still around on display anywhere?
Yeah.
Really?
One in South Orange at the Cameron Field called Tao, just next to the junior high school. Yes, they're all over America and parts of the world.
Oh, that's interesting, because I remember going to a museum back in like about 1968 in New York, on off of Fifth Avenue, and we got out onto the roof and there was a sculpture that your father had. Do you remember that? Okay, and I'm like telling people, oh, I know the guy that made this. And they're like looking at me like I'm crazy. But yeah, it was your father and the gymnasium and all in the house. Incredible. I had forgotten all about that. And we used to, you know, play hide and seek in the house years ago. It's great. I'm going to let someone else talk, but... because I could go on forever with all of the people and the parties that we went to and got thrown out of. And
we have time for one more.
Great. Hi, how are you? I think Judy mentioned in her introductory remarks that Seton, you had taken some coursework in the history of gardens. And when you were speaking, you said that when you went to Paris, you were really interested in taking photographs of gardens. So I guess my question is, when did this passion and interest and curiosity in gardens begin for you? Is it relatively new, or has it been a long time? And how do you think, has it started to affect your work, you know, your passion for gardens, how is that sort of working its way into your current work?
Around 1990, I became more interested in nature. Before, I wanted to photograph gardens as the idea of putting them as decor inside spaces. And then later in 90, I was going to conferences at a scientific place in Paris and hearing all about ecology and deep ecology and all different things like that. And I became really interested in trees, and I was photographing lots of trees. And then I made several site-specific projects, the one Lynne mentioned of the road sign with the tree on it. And it was like it was on a very banal rural road. And it was an advertisement of the local landscape. And there were five panels going to the sea and five panels going back to the town. And I made other projects that are photographs of nature in nature. And just to bring awareness of what do we think we need from nature in our time? And is artificial nature something that's fine or not? Or just to provoke people thinking about it. And I've read a lot about gardens and visited many of them. And so...
Can I ask, do you think that was also... was that affected by growing up in South Orange at all? I mean, was the garden a place that held a lot of interest for you when you guys were growing up?
Well, we were very lucky because we had a double lot where we lived, and so we really spent a lot of time out in the yard. And then when my father bought another house in Orange, that was also a double lot, and so... we really spent a lot of time outside and got connected with nature there and going to the reservation often. And so I think it's shown up later in both of our works, actually. And now I'm just focused on houses, the outside of houses. But, you know, nature will, I'm sure, come back again.
I actually come here from an entirely different perspective. I know you mainly because your aunt was my student, Graziella Smith, and her son, Tom, is a good friend of mine, and I've painted him a lot. And I very much want to paint both of you. You look gorgeous up there, I must say. But your uncle was an architect. I know that, Tom, so I, and actually, his son does a lot of, he's a non-objective painter. I mean, he's terrific, I think. And he does also sculpture, but his work also has this quality of nature. And I think both your work is like, that's what unites it. The buildings are in nature. Your people are in nature. Your people are with animals from nature. And there are trees in your work. I mean, I see, nobody ever met Graziella Smith, but she was like unbelievable. And she was, I just wanted to bring, I see you in a different context, I must say, but it's terrific. I think it's an extraordinary family, really.
Okay. Oh, one more.
This has been a terrific experience for me because seeing you, hearing you speak, looking at your images, I had this tremendous feeling of poetry. There was some kind of poetic sensibility between the panel and the images, and I know both your work, and I do see a similarity, a poetic, a symbiotic kind of comparison for me. I wondered if you wanted to discuss if you are influenced by poetry. Thank you.
I'd say poetry touches both our works in a way, and it's something we grew up with. Our father would read poetry, and Finnegan's Wake and things like that, The Wasteland. and so it's a music we grew up with.
For me, certain poets have been extremely influential in my life, both from their work and personally. Knowing certain, certainly like Meme Bersenbrugge, who's from New Mexico, and Anne Waldman, and different poets. But Meme Bersenbrugge is someone whose work has very much impacted the way I think and the way nature has entered my work in a way. And I think certain things in her work that mandated me to think about things in a different way. But certainly many other poets too. But she's been a very big influence on me.
Okay. I know we said that was the last question. Do we have to go? I know you're on a timeline, but we had one more. One more? Okay.
Cool. I didn't see anybody. I can't see. I don't know what's happening.
Good evening. I'm an art teacher. I specifically teach AP art history, and it just so happens that the college AP art history, it's a college level high school art history class, and the college board actually selected one of your works, Kiki Smith, to represent the global contemporary artists. They selected Lying with the Wolf.
Uh-huh.
And it comes into question a lot, you know, why the works are selected. Would the artists choose that as a work to basically represent their oeuvre? The College Board also represented Michelangelo by the Sistine Chapel ceiling as opposed to a sculpture, which I think Michelangelo would more readily identify with. So I was just kind of curious, would that be a work that you would choose yourself as a representation of your oeuvre? Is it, I mean, I'm just kind of curious what your thoughts on that as a representation of you would be, or your work.
You know, I always think I always say it's like practicing for being dead. You know, like you have no control over what other people are doing, and you can look at that as an opportunity or something that's really like whacked you, and you know, that you're internally miserable about. So to me, it's like a lot better strategy to say that's just like a really great idea that they chose that. And, you know, I'm very flattered that they're, you know, people are thinking about me in their spare time to begin with, period. So, yeah, why not? You know, and also because like one, like artists are endlessly disowning what they do, owning what you do, and then disowning it and getting sick of it and saying, oh no, that was a long time ago. I don't do that. I don't think those thoughts anymore. I'm not that person anymore. You know, and so it's good not to be too attached in your own chronology about what's significant or what's not, because also what's significant to you or to others is constantly coming into being and eroding. You know, we all are just turning to dust, and our work is turning to dust. And, you know, so that anybody thinks about it for more than a half a second, you're lucky to begin with. So, and if we can think about it more than a half a second, we're lucky. So, yeah, why not? Thank you.
Do you want to say something?
No.
Okay. I wanted to thank you all so much for coming. I wanted to particularly thank Lynne Tillman, Kiki, and Seton for coming. This is very fascinating and illuminating. Thank you.